Report from Santa Fe is made possible in part by grants from the members of the National Education Association of New Mexico, an organization of professionals who believe that investing in public education is an investment in our state's economic future, and by a grant from the Healy Foundation, Taos, New Mexico.
Hello, I'm Lorene Mills, and welcome to Report from Santa Fe. We have the perfect guests for our times now. Mel Goodman, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. The pleasure's all mine.
You're on a book tour, a national book tour, for your new book, Whistleblower at the CIA. And the subtitle is An Insider's Account of the Politics of Intelligence. Now, we are in a maelstrom of you have many other books. You have National Insecurity, and what does that have a subtitle?
The Cost of American Militarism.
Ooh, and The Failure of Intelligence, The Decline and Fall of the CIA.
Yes.
So tell us about your background. I love that you started out as a cryptographer. And then tell me about your 42 years in government and which agencies. And
well, it was 42 years with the government, including the United States Army as a cryptographer, but also the CIA for 24 years and the National War College, where I was professor of international security. And for 2 years, I was at the Department of State, the Bureau of Intelligence and Research. And all of that work, for the most part, has been dealing with the Soviet Union. I got my PhD at the Russian Institute at Indiana University. And I think I was attracted to the world of intelligence because of my work as a cryptographer.
And now you are you're a senior fellow at the Center for International Policy in D.C.
In Washington, D.C.
And an adjunct professor at Johns Hopkins.
Yes.
Good.
Where I went to school.
Ah, so did my mother. Yes. So Russia, there's no bigger story right now nationally than what's happening with this administration, the Trump administration, and Russia. It's a whole new chapter in Russia, in Russian relations. Could you give us, even before the Cold War, a little thumbnail sketch of how things used to be with our relations with Russia? I can't even say Soviet Union anymore. And what's happening now?
Well, I think what needs to be understood, and it's not properly covered, is that the United States' failure to take advantage of the decline and fall of the Soviet Union. In 1991, when the Soviet Union collapsed, and no one anticipated this dissolution, and those who wrote about it said it would only be in the context of war. So no one expected the peaceful decline of the Soviet Union. The United States had a remarkable strategic opportunity to reassess relations with Russia and to improve the Russian-American relationship. And that's exactly what we didn't do. So if you look at the presidents, Bill Clinton, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, they all contributed to this failure. But now, in a current period of what I call Russian hysteria, there's this tendency to totally demonize Vladimir Putin. And I'm not going to carry a brief for Putin, but I think we have to understand that the United States made many strategic blunders. And, of course, the first one was Bill Clinton's expansion of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which was a betrayal of what we said to them. My wife and I did a book on Edward Shevardnadze, the Soviet foreign minister, mm-hmm. and I interviewed Shevardnadze, and I interviewed his counterpart, James Baker, the American Secretary of State. And we told Shevardnadze, and we told Gorbachev that we would not take advantage of their retreat from East Germany to leapfrog into East Europe. And that's exactly what Clinton did by bringing in East European states. And George W. Bush made it worse by bringing in former republics of the Soviet Union. So you add to that George W. Bush's abrogation of the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty, the cornerstone of strategic deterrence, and the deployment of a regional missile system that makes no sense whatsoever, the one in Poland and Romania by Bush, and then Barack Obama. And now you have this terribly tight situation between Moscow and Washington that needs to be improved. So I must say, even though I'm quite critical of Donald Trump, his candidacy, and now his stewardship of American national security policy, we need to find a way to improve relations with Russia. That's going to be very difficult to do.
Well, I don't think that the way they're doing it is working right now, but please comment on this.
They certainly don't have a modus operandi.
Yeah.
In fact, one of the bizarre aspects of the Trump presidency in just a few months is why he's been so critical of all of our natural allies, and neighbors, Canada and Mexico, I would put in with our European allies, mm-hmm. and so glowing in terms of explaining relations with an authoritarian leader in Turkey or an authoritarian king in Saudi Arabia,
or
let alone the authoritarian leader in Russia. So we need to understand what it is Trump is trying to do. And when you look at the fact that he's appointed a national security team dominated by generals, and I taught colonels who were becoming generals at the War College for 18 years, they're very anti-Russian. They're victims of their own agitation and propaganda in terms of their own training. So it really doesn't make a lot of sense to figure out, you know, try to figure out what it is Trump is trying to achieve.
Well, one thing that would help us figure it out is if there were any transparency. For him to have Kislyakov and the other ones in the Oval Office with no only Russian journalists covering it, no one from our side covering it, and then the famous G20 meeting with Tillerson, Putin, translator, and Putin's right hand, with, again, no objective record at all of what happened. Well, I mean, it just makes a paranoid person.
Tillerson particularly has gone out of his way to make sure there is no record. He doesn't want journalists traveling with him. He doesn't want to give access to press conferences. And I think basically Tillerson is trying to protect his ignorance. He has no background in foreign policy. He has no background in national security policy. He isn't in on some of the high-level meetings that the White House has held. And when you add to that we have an active duty general officer as the national security advisor, which I think the press has failed to criticize, it means there's no one with any real wisdom, any real institutional memory on Russian-American relations talking to Donald Trump about Russia, about Putin.
And it's especially because he does need education about the history of the relation between our two countries. Yes, things need to be improved, but we have a long history that you need to know before you put your foot in your mouth. This is one thing that wasn't on my list to talk with you about, but I'm so concerned about the dissolution of the diplomatic corps and the disemboweling of the State Department. We need, for there are things in everyday life that we need to have representation in these countries, and just for it to be a shell of what it used to be.
Well, when I wrote my previous book, National Insecurity, The Cost of American Militarism, I wrote about the decline of the State Department and the weak secretaries of state we've had certainly since George Shultz and James Baker. In fact, John Kerry is probably the exception to the rule in the past 20, 25 years. But we've never seen anything like the current situation in which you have a secretary of state with no institutional memory and no assistant secretaries of state who are usually the institutional memory of the State Department.
Yeah.
No serious deputies, no real expertise around him whatsoever, yet he's talking about foreign policy and issues that he has no command of whatsoever. Now, the problem with the decline of the State Department, it means the role of diplomacy has almost faded away in American policy, and you've allowed the Pentagon to take over national security conceptualization of policy, and this is extremely dangerous.
There's so much to say about that, but the subtitle of your whistleblower book, and by the way, although we're going to talk a lot of big contemporary issues, this is a thrilling read. I mean, what you went through.
Thank you.
And it's first person, and you name names that I've known about all my life. So I would love to talk step by step about what happened to you, but some of these bigger issues, now that you're here, the subtitle is about the politicization of intelligence. What has happened to our intelligence agencies? And they've had different relationships with all the different presidents, but so there's a triumvirate here. We got our presidents and that political system. We've got the military, and then we've got the intelligence. How politicized are our intelligence agencies?
Well, they were designed not to be politicized. President Harry Truman wanted an agency to collect intelligence and to analyze intelligence for policymakers. They weren't supposed to be a part of the policy process. But his immediate successors, Eisenhower and Kennedy, took the CIA down the road of politicization by introducing covert action. And of course, President Eisenhower, who did so many good things in dealing with the Pentagon, allowed the CIA to take on tremendous covert action roles beginning in 1953 when the CIA and MI6, British intelligence, overthrew the democratically elected leader of Iran, Mossadegh, and introduced the corrupt Shah of Iran. Mm. That's why I find it very interesting that even today we talked about why can we deal with Iran? Why should we trust Iran? Well, why in the world should Iran trust the United States given our history from 1953 and Operation Ajax? So what has happened to the CIA in taking on a huge role of covert action, which presidents have given to them, because the CIA is not out there on its own hook planning these covert actions. These are White House policies. And all of the major covert actions, and we know them all, have been incredible failures. Cuba was a failure. Iran was a failure. Chile in the 1970s was a failure. When you look at CIA torture and abuse and the war on terror, the sadistic nature of torture and abuse, all of these have been incredibly terrible failures that have hurt the position of the United States and the community. So until you get a president who recognizes the important aspect of intelligence collection and analysis and moves away from this paramilitary policy that the CIA is involved in, I think we're going to have great difficulties with the intelligence communities.
Well, also, until we get a president who realizes that you don't fire the guy who's investigating you. I mean, so let's talk about that sort of politicization and talk about Comey and Bob Mueller and how can we possibly have a special counsel or investigative work. And you did a lot of work with the Senate intelligence committees, too. So give me a...
I learned a lot about the Senate political process in that experience. Let me add one name to the two you name, Comey and Mueller, and that would be Sally Yates.
Oh.
Because when I go back to May the 8th, 2017, that's the day this book came out, by the way, Whistleblower at the CIA.
After 11 months of them checking it out.
I would like to talk about that, too.
Yes.
But first, let me say something about Sally Yates. Sally Yates, to me, defines the role of a whistleblower. And she said it best at a graduation speech she gave last month at Harvard, which was barely covered by the press, when she talked about the moment when she decided that she needed to be a whistleblower was when law and her conscience sort of intersected.
Mm-hmm.
And she said there was no time to be introspective. There was no time to be cognitive about this. She knew what the White House was doing and what General Michael Flynn, his national security advisor, was doing were wrong. And this is basically what she told the White House. For that, she was fired, essentially. So she's an important whistleblower. Comey comes along a month later, exactly, June the 8th, 2017, and I think he becomes a whistleblower when he talks about the efforts Trump made to get an assurance or vow of loyalty to the President of the United States, forgetting that when all government officials raise their right hand, as I did, it's to the Constitution of the United States. It's not to a president. It's not to a party. It's not to the White House. So my narrow definition of whistleblowing, or a narrow definition of a whistleblower, is someone who is trying to correct a wrong. That's what Sally Yates was doing. That's what Jim Comey was doing. That's what Bob Mueller, who has very important credentials for probity and integrity. And that's essentially what I was trying to do in talking about politicization. What people need to know is we have fought too many wars in this country before the CIA, in some cases, with politicized intelligence. The Mexican-American War, the Spanish-American War, the Vietnam War, and of course, the worst example of all, the Iraq War.
And that's what caused you... You know, tell them.
Well, it was the politicization of intelligence on the Soviet Union in the 1980s that forced me to go public, to become a dissident, and ultimately to testify against Robert Gates as a CIA director because he was the filter for politicization of intelligence for William Casey, the CIA director.
We're speaking today with Mel Goodman about his amazing book, Whistleblower at the CIA. I want to stay on whistleblowers just a little bit longer because you talk about, you know, some of the famous whistleblowers in the past. You've worked with Daniel Ellsberg, the Pentagon Papers, the Vietnam War whistleblower. As a matter of fact, he did a wonderful blurb for your book. But go through some of the most controversial whistleblowers, and you feel that with time that they really have been vindicated.
My argument is truth of this type is initially ridiculed, then it's opposed, but then over a period of time, it becomes self-affirming. And that was certainly true for Daniel Ellsberg and the Vietnam Papers. And what people have forgotten, if they ever knew, is that Ellsberg gave the Pentagon Papers to two senators before he ever gave the papers to the press. And they were returned. And that was Senator William Fulbright, who returned the Pentagon Papers, which was unbelievable to me. Because basically, what Ellsberg was revealing was all of the false history and rationale and explanations and assumptions that led us into the terrible disaster that Vietnam was. Now, a very controversial whistleblower, who in a way has already been vindicated, is Edward Snowden, and I know he's controversial. I believe he's a whistleblower because he was trying to correct the wrong of massive surveillance. People were very critical of him, accusing him of treason, which I think is unfair because he fled the country, without understanding why he left the country to reveal these materials. And that was because of a previous whistleblower at the National Security Agency, whose name is not as well known as Edward Snowden. His name is Thomas Drake. Drake did everything right. He went to the Inspector General of the National Security Agency with his revelations. He went to the Inspector General of the Department of Defense. He went to the Senate Intelligence Committee and the House Intelligence Committee. And at the House Intelligence Committee, a staffer by the name of Diane Roark said to him, "Tom, the only way you're going to get that story out is to go to the press." He went to the press with unclassified documents. It was the government that later on reclassified documents that had been declassified. And then it was President Obama who used the Espionage Act of 1917, which had nothing to do with Drake, with what Drake was doing, to really pursue him with a 35-year jail sentence.
And yet
before
Obama,
a judge threw it out of the court, essentially.
Obama had promised to protect whistleblowers.
Obama, I was a supporter of Obama, but I must say the great disappointment was this man, a Harvard Law graduate, someone who taught constitutional law in Chicago, and said, as you say, would protect whistleblowers, used the Espionage Act against whistleblowers more than all of our presidents since 1917. And even in the case of Drake, that issue was on the desk of George W. Bush. George W. Bush did not pursue Thomas Drake, but it was Obama and Eric Holder, the Attorney General, who went after Drake in the worst possible way. And let me say one other thing about Edward Snowden. It was former Attorney General Eric Holder who referred to Snowden just several months ago in an interview as a public servant in terms of what he did. That's what I mean when I say that whistleblowers tend to be vindicated.
One other controversial area that has to do with the politicization of intelligence, but also the weaponization of intelligence, what about WikiLeaks?
Well, I think WikiLeaks, if you look at the original charter, the original mandate, the original MO, of WikiLeaks was to expose high-level institutions in terms of corruption, whether they were corporations or national governments. And I give Julian Assange at the outset credit for that, but somewhere along the line, Assange fell off the rails, and I think his focus and contempt for Hillary Clinton really came through and found him in a situation where he was revealing potentially sensitive information. A lot of this was overdone by the press, only in one direction, which was to defeat Hillary Clinton. So it's ironic to me that Julian Assange and Vladimir Putin somehow ended up on the same page, a page that Donald Trump clearly turned when he called for a Russian investigation of her emails. And now we're learning so much about Donald Trump Jr. and the prodigal son-in-law and the former campaign director meeting with a Russian delegation that may have included a counterintelligence agent from the Russian military. So this story gets more curious day by day.
Curiouser and curiouser. I find, you know, I've watched several of your lectures and read just the one book, but I'm going to start reading them all, that you really provide a wake-up call for us to reform the intelligence practices. And Seymour Hersh, a journalist of the First Water, said, "Goodman has spent the last few decades telling us what's gone wrong with American intelligence and the American military. He's also telling us how to save ourselves. So how can we reform these processes, and how can we save our republic?"
Well, if the American people don't get involved in these issues and don't start calling congressmen and don't start writing letters to the editor and don't get out of their living rooms, I don't think we can change any of this. It's got to be from the bottom up. It's clearly not going to be from the top down. And I've lobbied on the Hill, and I've been told by many staffers, we get calls on domestic policy. We get calls when there are too many airplanes flying over backyard barbecues. We never get calls on foreign policy or national security issues. So the American people have to come in and into the arena and help with this fight.
One of your wonderful lines is that the presidency is a ship that leaks from the top down.
Yes.
Instead of, you said that we've got to be working from the bottom
up. From the bottom up.
One of my favorite quotes by Ben Franklin, I can only paraphrase it, but he says, "Those who give up liberty for security deserve neither." Well, where do we stand with that?
We've given up so much of our liberty, and this is something the founding fathers, not only Franklin, but as a group, particularly James Madison, wrote about. This is something President Eisenhower believed, that in any era of permanent war, we lose personal liberty, we lose civic liberty. And when you look at the United States in the so-called global war on terror, which was a terrible overreaction to 9/11, which found ourselves shooting ourselves in, not in the foot, but in both feet,
yeah.
We've given up so much. When you think about terror and abuse, unconstitutional, massive surveillance, unconstitutional, due process, the case against Chelsea Manning and the way that was handled was a serious constitutional failure, I believe. And this has happened in terms of what's in the press coverage of this election and the false equivalence issue in which Donald Trump clearly was not taken seriously.
Yeah.
And now look at where we are.
Right. Well, you do speak, and it's a very dear issue for me, the freedom of the press. And you do mention the failure of the false equivalency between Trump and Mrs. Clinton, and that it was a free ride for Trump. The amount of publicity he got just by being outrageous. You know, you just couldn't, for months, he led the news every night and got a huge amount of free press. And now,
too many people took him literally, but not seriously.
Yeah, I know.
And now this is where we are.
Yeah. What do you think will happen with the special counsel?
I think over the long term, they're going to dig up a lot of conniving, maybe even some elements, suggestive elements of collusion. I don't think they're going to find issues that are going to lead to impeachment. And I would warn people that counterintelligence investigations, which this is, are extremely long in nature. Mm-hmm. Look at the Iran-Contra investigation. That was 6 years. If this runs anywhere close to that, Trump could be in his second term.
Yeah.
I think there are people around Trump who are in legal jeopardy. Former National Security Advisor General Flynn, I think, is facing serious legal issues. And it could be that Jared Kushner also is facing serious issues. And I think they're going to find some examples of money laundering. You know, I think Trump became known to the Russians not because he was Donald Trump, but because Donald Trump was dealing with the oligarchs. Putin is obsessed with the power, particularly the potential political power of the oligarchs. And Donald Trump clearly was taking in a lot of money that was leaving Russia.
Selling.
His own son has said that a disproportionate amount of money was coming into the Trump Corporation from Russia. That money is still leaving Russia because no one believes that Putin can keep this regime together for much longer.
Well, and also the actual money laundering, there were several mansions that Trump sold for way more, hundreds times more than he paid for
when he
for
was
it.
Facing serious debt issues with his own real estate holdings.
Yeah, and the other glacial investigations that disturb me are the ethics and the violations of the emoluments clauses.
Well, the fact that he's allowed to own a hotel in which he's the landlord and also someone who's leasing the property makes no sense whatsoever. That's a clear violation of the Emoluments Clause.
Yes. What should we look for coming up?
Well, one thing you can look for is my next book.
Good. Tell me about
Donald
it.
Donald Trump's War on Intelligence.
Well, because that works on a lot of levels.
It does work on a lot of levels. Because the one thing about Trump that I find fascinating is his war is against anyone who collects intelligence, whether it's the intelligence community itself. He certainly has a war against the CIA. He compared the CIA to what went on in Nazi Germany even before he was inaugurated. He has a war on the media, identifying the media
fake
as
news.
Enemy of the people. Well, in talking about fake news, he's created tremendous confusion in the United States. When I go out and lecture, there's tremendous confusion about what it is people can read and believe and how do they separate news from fake news. Well, fake news to Trump is anything that's critical of the Trump administration. And when you remember that the press for too long has allowed the government to control what's in the press, I used to tell people that 90% of what you read in the mainstream media is what the government wants to put into the media. There's an unwillingness to talk to contrarians an unwillingness to allow dissidents to write op-ed articles. That's why I think what PBS does and what talk radio does is allow more aspects of our national security environment to be discussed. The media is doing its job now because I think the entire country has awakened into this arena in which they find a great deal of uncertainty, too much cynicism, questions about integrity, questions about trust and truth, but it's kind of late in the game. We need some activism.
Well, yes. You had mentioned earlier about the Iran-Contra Commission and the 9/11, that they work hard, they get a lot of stuff out, but they never really get to the bottom of it, do they?
I never feel they really get to the bottom. The 9/11 Commission was supposed to be a bipartisan commission, but really what you had is Democratic members protecting a Democratic President Clinton and Republican members protecting a Republican President Bush. And I think the intelligence community, and particularly the CIA, got off. The CIA was guilty of a tremendous intelligence failure with regard to 9/11. 9/11 did not have to happen. And let me say one thing on behalf of those who collect intelligence. The collection of intelligence in the intelligence community is outstanding. The failures that I've written about, the failures that I talk about, have been analytical failures, either corrupt in terms of politicization, the work of William Casey and Robert Gates with regard to the Soviet Union in the 1980s, or the work of George Tenet and John McLaughlin with regard to weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, or legitimate failures, just getting something wrong. But the collection is usually outstanding.
Well, we'll have to leave it there. Our guest today is Mel Goodman. I cannot recommend this book highly enough. I really was just tore through it. Whistleblower at the CIA, an insider's account of the politics of intelligence. We have a lot to learn about this. Thank you for coming and sharing your wisdom.
Thank you for the opportunity.
And I'm Lorene Mills. I'd like to thank you, our audience, for being with us today on Report from Santa Fe. We'll see you next time.
Past archival programs of Report from Santa Fe are available at the website reportfromsantafe.com. If you have questions or comments, please email info@reportfromsantafe.com. Report from Santa Fe is made possible in part by grants from the members of the National Education Association of New Mexico, an organization of professionals who believe that investing in public education is an investment in our state's economic future, and by a grant from the Healy Foundation, Taos, New Mexico.